Hello there. Welcome to this video thing. My name is Megan, and I am a professional artist who lives and works in Los Angeles. And today I'm going to be giving you some tips and tricks that I like to use when painting something in Photoshop. These are gonna be more, I guess, like beginner level tips. The thing is, I've been creating artwork every single day for like 7 days a week, 8 hours a day kind of situation for like 6 years now. So a lot about creating artwork comes very naturally to me. It's very intuitive, it's very instinctual. But I know that when I first started learning about art and how to make art, especially digital art, which is difficult in its own way, there's a lot of things that I know now that I wish that someone had explained to me when I started off. Today we are going to be making a digital illustration in Photoshop, fully in Photoshop, nothing else will be used, and it's going to be very, very simple concept. We're going to have a bear, cute bear, and he's gonna be holding a little bouquet of flowers, and he's gonna be standing in a meadow. Very easy, very simple. There's not a lot of story there. Honestly, there's not a lot of story in my artwork anyway, because I'm lazy when it comes to personal artwork, and I just like to make things that make me happy and make other people happy, and I try not to focus too much on like being like a good artist or whatever, doing all of the rules of storytelling and blah blah blah, whatever. So yeah, we're gonna be painting bear in a meadow. He's gonna have some flowers in his hands because he picked flowers. That's it. And we're gonna be making it in Photoshop. My first Photoshop tip is to start off super fucking simple. Before I did anything with my illustration, I started off with a very tiny, very small, maybe like 1 inch by 1 inch color study. If it's really small and it reads, it's going to be successful. So everything you make, you should be able to hang it up on the wall and like walk all the way across the room and look at it and be able to understand everything. Everything needs to be very clear and easy to understand. So already we have, in my little tiny color study, we figured out a lot of things. We have a lot of information. And because I figured out so much in that tiny little small color study, it's going to be much easier to start painting. So that's what we're gonna be doing. We're gonna start painting right now. And the way you do that is the concept of light on dark, dark on light. If you have a dark thing on a light background, it's going to have contrast and it's going to be easier to understand. Vice versa is the same. If you have a very light thing on a dark background, it's gonna be very easy to see what the shape is. It's gonna be easy to understand. You're gonna be able to look at your piece from across the room and immediately understand it. I figured out that the sky was gonna be light, the grass was going to be dark, and the bear was going to be very dark, darker than the sky and the grass. And because the bear had his head silhouetted against the light sky, it was gonna be the focal point and it was gonna be very easy to understand. So that's the first thing. When I'm setting up an image, if I'm setting up an illustration, is what's the focal point, which is where do I wanna look? I wanna look at my bear. And is the focal point light on dark or dark on light? In this situation, it's dark on light, which makes him the focal point. You look right at him. The second thing that I like to think about when I'm setting up an image and I'm doing a color study is where is the light coming from? It's very simple in concept. For me, for this image, the light is coming from the right-hand side and it's sort of behind the bear. There is this phenomenon where the color study is going to be unachievable. It's going to be this beautiful, perfect, little, tiny, amazing thing, and it's going to be very difficult when you're making the final piece for it to ever live up to the color study. But don't let it intimidate you. I promise there will be a moment when you're making the final piece where you will finally feel like, okay, I did it. I captured whatever it was about the color study, and I also added a bunch of detail. So this next tip is something that like logically makes a lot of sense, but I wish that someone had explained it to me a long time ago so I didn't have to figure it out myself, so I'm explaining it to you right now. We are painting a meadow. And so we have light coming down from the sky, and we have leaves and grass and flowers. The way I approach this is the ground is going to be pretty dark, a pretty dark, not saturated color as like the base for the ground. And the reason I did that is because there's going to be flowers sitting above the grass and the ground. And if you think about it, the light is going to have a much easier time hitting the flowers than it is the ground underneath the flowers. It's an easy concept, but I wish someone had explained it to me much earlier. I start off with dark base, and I'm going to put lighter and more saturated flowers and leaves on top of that and just start layering. There's a couple ways that I introduced the foliage into this piece. The first is I got another file, empty file. I grabbed a lasso tool and I just started making flower and leaf shapes. I maybe placed 4 or 5 of those stamps into my image before I felt okay, I guess. The whole point of it for me was to just populate the image. A lot of the times when you're making something and you're about to add detail, it can feel kind of like daunting. It can be sort of intimidating. For me, sometimes making art is easier when there's more to look at. So like looking at a blank piece of paper or a white canvas can be really intimidating. But if I have, you know, I add a color for the base, or I add a dark color, or add some sort of brush stroke, it can be a lot easier for me to go off of that, because you can look at something and be like, that's wrong and I'm gonna fix it, versus looking at a white piece of something and feeling like it has to be perfect from the start. And then once I felt like there was enough there for me to go off of, I just used my lasso tool and just started creating flowers and leaves just in the actual illustration native to the image. Oh, the other thing I wanted to talk about with the lasso tool. If you've never created artwork with a lasso tool, I really, 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 like super highly recommend it. I couldn't recommend it more, and here is why. Photoshop especially, there is a giant disconnect between what your hand is doing and what's happening on the canvas, because there's a lot of lag. When you are drawing on paper, there's immediate feedback. You immediately know what the stroke you just put down looks like. With Photoshop, you can go like this and you can take your pen off of the screen and it's still drawing whatever you put down. With the lasso tool, you can make the shape that you want and then you just have to fill it in with 1 or 2 brush strokes. And for me at least, you don't have to fuck around with like making a clean edge. A lot of the times with some of these like texture brushes, it could take forever to create that like outline or that silhouette that's like what you had in your head or what you're trying to do with your hand. With the lasso tool, you get a very clean edge and you don't have to sit there and try and... It would take me forever to do all of those flowers with just a brush versus the way I did it with the lasso tools. Once I had a pretty good amount of those little lasso tool flowers and leaves, the next thing I did was create foliage brushes. I haven't created brushes in a really long time, actually. I had so much fun making them, actually. When you are looking at a meadow, there are probably hundreds, if not thousands, hundreds of thousands of blades of grass and hundreds of flowers. And there's no way in heck that you are ever going to populate a meadow in an illustration by yourself. You are not gonna spend 10 years to draw every single blade of grass. So you can make brushes or you can use someone else's brushes. I do both. And you can use those brushes to create an indication of detail in the background. And you can do the same thing in the front, to be honest, because you're also not gonna paint the hundreds of blades of grass and the hundreds of leaves that are in the front. You can maybe do 20 or 30 of them in the front, and then you can start taking those little stamps or those little brushes that have a shape and just start populating again. That's exactly what I did. It's a very easy process, or at least easier for me to think about. The other thing I did with the flowers was I put them in a couple different layers. So I had the foreground layer, I had a mid-ground layer, and a background, and then a very back, like super background layer. So I had like four or five layers where I had flowers that just kept going back. and I had it so that none of the flowers in the foreground were like touching each other, so that I could alpha lock the layers and start adding lighting. That is another thing that took me way too long to learn when I first started making illustrations. Have everything, or as much as you can, have everything on its own layer, alpha lock it, so click the little transparency lock, and then just paint the lighting into it without having to spend so much time worrying about like the edge control. Obviously, if you are an experienced artist, this probably isn't gonna be helpful for you, but this is something that I just fucking wish that someone had told me and I didn't have to learn myself. All right, so let's get to the clouds, because that's what I started working on next. I had a little bit of a different method for the clouds. I actually used the polygon lasso tool to create the clouds, but I just wanted to have the clouds kind of go like all the way diagonally across the whole image. I wanted like two chunks of clouds that were going diagonal, and it happened to just be a little bit easier to do that with the polygon lasso tool. Everything is an arrow. Everything you draw, everything, every color, every value in your artwork is an arrow. So for example, the clouds in this piece, two diagonal lines that are pointing inward and outward. So you have to be really careful with these big arrows that you have in your piece for a couple of reasons. You want, for the most part, for there to be one or two dominant arrows that are pointing at your focal point. And the other part of it is that whatever arrows you have, you want to make sure that they aren't pointing off and out of the image. There are a couple ways to, I guess, think about it, but my biggest thing is that if you have an arrow that's pointing off and leading your eye off and out of the illustration, to either darken it or to lighten it so that it's sort of not as much of a hard edge, find a way to disrupt or soften or get rid of that harsh directional line that's leading you out of the illustration. All right, so we're painting the clouds. The thing is, this isn't a beginner concept at all. It took me a very long time to learn and realize this, but I actually did some photo bashing in the clouds and a little bit also on the little mountains and hills that are in the background. I wouldn't recommend anyone who's maybe new to painting or to digital art to rely on photo bashing or to learn photo bashing right away. But if there are enough people interested, I will do a tutorial on how I use photo bashing. Also, I should recognize that like people used to get like ridiculed and kicked off of the internet for using photos in their artwork, which is a strange concept to me, because if I were to get my Photoshop file and turn off the image layer, it probably wouldn't change the illustration that much. I've manipulated the photo a lot, I've painted over it, I've added my own like thoughts as an artist to the image. It's not like I just grabbed like a picture of clouds, stuck it in there, and like called it a day. And yeah, basically, we have a bear who has picked up some flowers and he's standing in a meadow. Very simple idea and concept. The last thing that I want to talk about and recommend for digital art. So when you're making art on a computer, you are staring at a light source. Basically, you're looking at something and you're trying to create something while there are a bunch of tiny little light bulbs just blasting light into your eyes. Because of that, a lot of the times you're going to make something a lot more gray, and a lot of your values are going to get kind of smushed together because you're looking at a light source. When I finally do get to the end of the image where all of the texture is there, all of, you know, everything that I want in the image is there, all the flowers, the blades of grass, the bear, the clouds, like everything is there. I like to go into what I call like the post-production stage, which for an illustration is, it's not that long. Whereas if you're creating like a video or an animation, post-production is a much longer process. The first thing I like to do when I have finished an image is add a levels layer. So unless I'm looking to create something that doesn't have a lot of contrast and is more like pastel and like moody or whatever, I will take the whites and I'll take the blacks, I'll add a levels layer and I'll smush them together a little bit. So we have more contrast. Usually if you flip that layer on and off, you'll be like, what was I thinking? This image was so boring before I put this layer on. The other thing I like to do is color balance, and sometimes it helps, sometimes it doesn't. For this image, I turned the blues up a little bit on the color balance because the whole image was looking very orange. That was kind of the predominant color, and I wanted just a teeny tiny bit of blue in there just to balance it out some more. Another post-production thing that I always do is one overlay layer and one multiply layer. For the overlay layer, that's basically my lights and my brights. I'll get a somewhat yellowy color, light yellowy color, and I'll get a poofy brush, big poof brush, go pop on the bits that I want to be light. So I put it on that big streak of yellow in the meadow. I added a little bit to the rim of the bear and a little bit to the front where the flowers are. Obviously, I will turn the opacity on that layer down, and I'll also erase out of it quite a bit. Then I will go onto my multiply layer, and it'll usually be like a desaturated gray blue or purple, depending on the image. And I'll go in there, big poofy brush, and add some cool darker colors to the image in the shadows. I make sure that unless we have a really, really hot shadow where there's a lot of light in the shadow, I make sure that my overlay and my multiply layers don't touch each other, because that kind of creates like a lot of muddiness, at least in my experience. The last thing that I will do is I will start to use blur filters, which, listen to me right now, do not go overboard with these. But I'll copy all, I will copy merge my whole image, I'll paste it onto a new layer, and I'll go into my filters and I'll do a lens blur or a Gaussian blur. For this piece, I did a lens blur, and then I will erase out of that layer. You want to make sure that your focal point is fully in focus. No blur should be on your focal point. It needs to be very like crisp and like good crispy detail. I have a little bit of blur on the like clouds, a little bit on like the little hills and like the very far back meadow. It was good for me to do this because there was a lot of like little tiny detail and lots of hard edges on some of the clouds and that far background that maybe wasn't necessary and maybe a little distracting from the focal point. It's so easy with these digital mediums to just zoom in like 200-300% and add all of these tiny little crunchy details that your eye probably wouldn't see, and also is maybe distracting a little bit from your focal point. So yeah, that's how I create a digital illustration in Photoshop. I've been making art for a long time, and a lot of this stuff comes so intuitively to me that saying a lot of this stuff just sounds like too like obvious to me, like I'm saying stuff that should be obvious to people. But when I think back to me as an 18-year-old, I wish that someone had told me a lot of what I just told you. It would have helped me if I had learned some of this stuff earlier on. Yeah, so I hope that this was helpful, and if it wasn't helpful, you got to look at my stupid face and hear me talk and maybe be entertained for a little bit. I don't know. I don't know why you watch my videos. Also, just some housekeeping things. Cozytober is still happening. I'm still doing Let me show you. I'm still doing little Cozytober sketches in my little sketchbook every day. I just haven't been posting them because, to be quite frank, I've been making some really serious posts and videos lately, and it feels kind of weird to one day be like, hey, there's this super serious thing happening, and then like a couple hours later be like, here's my Cozytober. Like, I want to give that stuff enough time to breathe. So I'm probably just going to be doing like a Cozytober sketchbook flip through at the end of the month. And I hope that's okay with you guys. I hope that you guys will continue to support me even though my life is crazy and stressful and all this is going on. I appreciate everyone who's been so kind and supportive. All right, if you guys want me to put up a photo bashing tutorial, or you want me to put up some of the brushes I made for this video on Gumroad or whatever, if there's interest for it, I'll do it, I guess. Let me know if you enjoyed this or if it was helpful. I hate plugging myself, but I'm gonna do it anyway. I sell original artwork and I also sell prints and stuff on my Etsy and my Redbubble. I will link those things below if you want to purchase art from me. Go ahead and subscribe to this channel and like this video if you liked this video. Go follow my Instagram, my Twitter, my TikTok, wherever. And yeah, I hope you have a great rest of your day. I hope to see you again, and goodbye.